Good morning. Our service of Holy Eucharist Rite 2 can be found on our website at coascension.org, as well as our Facebook and YouTube pages, the Episcopal Church of the Ascension, Montgomery, Alabama. Please stand and join in singing hymn 477. Our service of Holy Eucharist Rite 2 begins on page 355 of the Book of Common Prayer. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known, and from you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. Amen.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty and everlasting God, whose will it is to restore all things in your well-beloved Son, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, mercifully grant that the peoples of the earth, divided and enslaved by sin, may be freed and brought together under his most gracious rule, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. You may be seated for the lessons.
His word is upon my tongue. The God of Israel has spoken. The Rock of Israel has said to me, one who rules over people justly, ruling in the fear of God, is like the light of morning, like the sun rising on a cloudless morning, gleaming from the rain on the grassy land. Is not my house like this with God? For he has made with me an everlasting covenant, ordered in all things and secure. Will he not cause to prosper all my help and my desire? But the godless are like the thorns that are thrown away, for they cannot be picked up with the hand. To touch them, one uses an iron bar or the shaft of a spear, and they are entirely consumed in the fire on the spot. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Psalm 132 can be found in your insert or on page 785 of the Book of Common Prayer. From the book of Revelation. Grace to you and peace from him who is and who was and who is to come, and from the seven spirits who are before his throne, and from Jesus Christ, the faithful witness, the firstborn of the dead, and the ruler of the kings of the earth. To him who loves us and freed us from our sins by his blood, and made us to be a kingdom, priests serving his God and Father, to him be glory and dominion forever and ever. Amen. Look, he is coming with the clouds. Every eye will see him, even those who pierced him. And on his account, all the tribes of the earth will wail. So it is to be. Amen. I am the Alpha and the Omega, says the Lord God, who is and who was and who is to come, the Almighty. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please join in singing hymn 495 as the children process to Children's Church.
Thank you.
Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the King of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am a king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Christ. Good morning on this last Sunday in Pentecost, in which we recognize Christ the King Sunday. You may have noticed that all of our readings this morning reference either the kingdom of God or the reign of Christ as King. The celebration of this feast is a way for all of us as the church in our own particular liturgical way to affirm the sovereignty of Christ in a troubled world. Jesus is both human and divine, and in his dual nature, he is able to be for us an offering and a sacrifice. Not only is Christ the King Sunday the last Sunday in Pentecost, but it also signals the end of our church year as we usher in Advent and the beginning of a new church year. We will move from our Year B Sunday lectionary readings into Year C. We will also transition from Year 1 to Year 2 in our daily office lectionary readings. And as we close out our church year and move from one season to the next, I'm reminded of the lyrics from the band Semisonic's 1998 song Closing Time, in which they say, "Every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end." Now, while some of us children of the 90s may recognize these lyrics, and not that I doubt Semisonic's ability to capture certain philosophical ideas into song lyrics, this concept, however, appears to date back at least to the first century and to a Roman philosopher named Seneca the Elder. It renews itself by ending. Like the seasons and the church seasons, this quote speaks to the cyclical nature of life that is reflected ritually and liturgically in the life of the church, and especially in our church calendar. The cycle of Lent through Easter through Pentecost yields to a new cycle of Advent through Christmas through Epiphany. The end of one cycle yields to the beginning of a new cycle. We, as the body of Christ, both ritually and liturgically, live out the 33 years of Jesus' incarnate life here on earth every church year as we move through these cycles. We live out that life liturgically by marking the year with those pivotal events in Christ's life of conception, birth, baptism, teaching, ministry, suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension. And yes, the end of this beginning yields to a new beginning. Sounds like a liturgical version of that classic Bill Murray movie Groundhog Day. Maybe that is the point. We as the church get to keep moving through this cycle until we get it right. In that movie, Bill Murray's character, Phil, wakes up every morning destined to live that day over and over and over till he finally gets it right. Maybe that is what we are doing as Christians, living out our liturgical lives. We keep practicing until we finally get it right. As followers of Christ, we observe two conceptions of time. One is an historical conception of time in which we order events in terms of when they happened chronologically, events such as births, other life events, death events, in which we can quantify when they happened. But for Christians, we also recognize time in a way that is much more difficult to quantify. We sometimes call it mystical or eschatological time. This time is less easily defined and is more about engaging us in mystery and allowing truths to be revealed to us. For Bill Murray's character, Phil, he was able to move on from Groundhog Day when he finally grasped that life was about relationships and about love. I think maybe Jesus is giving us, the church, that collective body of Christ, that opportunity to keep practicing for what the kingdom of heaven will be, so that we will be ready and worthy to receive here on earth that wonderful gift of grace that God has promised to each of us. In this morning's gospel readings, we hear that portion of John's gospel that is often referred to as the trial. Jesus has been handed over to Pontius Pilate by the religious authorities, not because he has done anything wrong, but because he threatens the status quo. His radical way of love has challenged all that those who are in positions of leadership within the church hold dear. Jesus has challenged their traditions and, more importantly, their influence over the people. The Jewish religious authorities are not allowed to execute anyone, and so they present Jesus to Pilate, as he is the leading Roman governing authority in this region. They present him as someone challenging the secular Roman authority, and hence the need for his execution. One can almost, though, sense the apprehension in Pilate's voice in our gospel reading as he engages Jesus in this inquiry this morning. While the real encounter more than likely would not have proceeded like this, we can, as liturgical and as ritual Christians, possibly gather that Pilate seems to be trying to make the case that Jesus is of no harm. This possibly evidenced by his willingness to let him clear up some things. But Jesus never makes acclamations about leadership in the secular world or challenges the authority of Caesar on earth. But he does inform us about his authority in all things within the heavenly realm. In the end, Jesus will make his way to the cross, and in the ending of his temporal life here on earth, he will make all things new. Every new beginning comes from some other beginning's end. Unlike the movie Groundhog Day, in which Phil is trying to figure out what he gets wrong so that he can fix it and get unstuck from a vicious cycle, we as Christians, especially we as Episcopalians and liturgical Christians, we get to do this cycle over and over and over. For us, it is not so much about getting unstuck, but rather I think we are practicing. We're trying to hone, perfect those skills of loving one another. We are seeking to serve Christ, whom we find in all those with whom we come in contact. We hear the word king or kingdom at least 6 times in our gospel reading this morning. Jesus is our true sovereign, and his kingdom will have no end. Christ the King Sunday seeks to remind us of this. Christ the King Sunday is the end of our church year, but it also serves to usher in a new beginning. This is the beauty of our church year, that when something new emerges, it is not simply replacing the old, but rather what will emerge in our new church year will be because of what came before. This cycle of conversion is the fruit of a life lived in grace. This new beginning is the fruit of a man who hung from a cross 2,000 years ago and emerged from an empty tomb. Our church calendar is not reflective of an endless merry-go-round that moves with redundancy. It is always the same, but different. Each year and time we experience the readings and the seasons, we find ourselves in a different season of our own lives, and our relationship to the readings and to the liturgy is different. Our ritual brings calm. It brings framework and structure, but not the redundancy that we observed in Groundhog Day. It's not the same every time, because it is a living and breathing and moving relationship with God. That new beginning comes from Jesus's beginning's end. Amen.
We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. He came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshiped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy Catholic and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
The prayers of the people are according to Form 4, found on page 388, Kneeling as You Are Able. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the holy church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love, and be found without fault at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For Justin, the Archbishop of Canterbury, Michael, our President, for Glenda, our Bishop, for Candace and Drew, our clergy, for all bishops and other ministers, and for all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those in positions of public trust, especially Joe, our president, Kay, our governor, Stephen, our mayor, that they may serve justice and promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the poor, the persecuted, the sick, and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners, and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this congregation, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all we do, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those on our parish prayer list, Mimi Gallagher, Brett Hall, Clyde Eller, Glenn Kane, Nancy Morgan, Robin Stark, Ellen Brooks, Diane Williams, Bill Mahoney, Sam Knight, Jim Yoder, Chris Lewis, Al Cantrell, Sue Hicks, Violet Munson, Frances Hill, Edith Crook, Bill Wall, Betty Godbold, Sophie Zides, and Jane McConnell. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the safety of our armed forces, both here and abroad, and for Ascension Day School, we pray to you, O Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those in whose memory the altar flowers are given, Edgar Milton Lewis, Annie Holmes Lewis, and Ruby and Coley Clayton, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God. To you, O Lord, our God.
For yours is the majesty of Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
Yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
Turning to page 360, let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry, and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways, to the glory of your name. Amen. Almighty God, have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ. Strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit, keep you in eternal life. Amen. Please stand. The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Good morning and welcome, and it's a delight to be able to worship with all of you here in person and online. Thank you for that.
Just a few announcements. This afternoon at 4 p.m. is our community Thanksgiving service with the First Methodist Church and Temple Beth Orr. It will be held at the First Methodist Church today at 4. I do get to preach, so I hope I'll see a lot of your friendly, smiling faces out there while I'm standing in a foreign pulpit on foreign land. After the service, there will be a reception that First Methodist is offering for all of us, so I do hope we will be there to celebrate this time of gratitude and thanksgiving and give thanks with many in our community. On Sunday, December 5th, we will host our annual meeting immediately following this service at 10:30 a.m. And in preparation for that, you will receive a ballot for vestry elections in the mail the week before. That ballot is addressed to the voter. So every household that has multiple voters should receive multiple ballots. Your ballot must be returned to the church. If you want to turn it in prior to Sunday, December 5th, you have to bring it yourself. A spouse cannot bring your ballot for you, or a friend or a neighbor. It must be returned in person with your name matching your face on your ballot. If you did not receive a ballot by Tuesday or Wednesday, please reach out to us and let us know so we can make sure to get one to you, or we can let you know that you're actually not a member and what you need to do to become a member. But we do hope that you will participate in the annual meeting. We will offer it online. However, if there is a runoff, you must be present to vote for that runoff. So the meeting will be immediately following this service. We won't even leave the nave. Drew and I will just run over here and change clothes real quick, and we'll be right back where we'll start that meeting on December 5th. But in order to maintain the canonical standards of the voting with the annual meeting, we will actually open the meeting next Sunday immediately following the 10:30 service with a prayer and then go into recess. So the meeting will begin on November 28th and run through the end of that meeting on December 5th following the service. So if you have questions about that, feel free to call me and I can try to walk you through that. But otherwise, you should receive a ballot. It should have your name on it, and it needs to be turned in by the time of the annual meeting. We will vote at the very beginning of annual meetings. So if you do bring it back with you on that Sunday, if you forget it, that's okay. We will have a list of who has voted and who has not, and the vestry will have extra ballots for Sunday, December 5th to give to you, but we encourage you to bring your ballot with you. Next, October 18th through the 29th, Rabbi Scott Looper from Temple Beth Orr and I are hosting and inviting you to a pilgrimage in the Holy Lands. We will be taking this Episcopal Jewish pilgrimage together, focused mainly on archaeology and searching out those places that we find in Scripture, both the Old Testament and the New. There is more information about that in the e-news every Tuesday. And if you would like to have a more detailed itinerary, the price list, and other information, email me and I will send all of that to you so that you can begin to look at it. The deadline for that is April 15th, but we have only a limited number of spaces, so as soon as those fill up, then we'll be full. So just an FYI. And I want to tell just a little story, and this story was given to me this morning at breakfast. Jan, thank you. It's a beautiful little story. Jan was telling me about one day when she came here to the garden. She told me two stories. I'm just going to tell you one of them. And she found a woman from Pakistan and her little five-year-old boy that was with her. And they were coming into the garden, and Jan was in the garden at the same time. And she struck up a conversation with this woman, which, go Jan, great evangelist out there for the Church of the Ascension. And the woman told her that her son, every morning when he woke up, put on his shoes, jumped out of bed, put on his shoes, and told his mother he wanted to go to his garden. So this is a child who is not necessarily a Christian, but lives in our neighborhood and has been drawn to the beauty that we have provided through our Transfiguration Garden. And it has offered a five-year-old that sense of peace and joy and renewal and resurrection and relationship. And I am appreciative of knowing how much that garden has meant to us, but how much it has also meant to all of those who live in our neighborhood. and how we are growing relationships with people, not only amidst ourselves in this congregation, but in our community and especially in our neighborhood. So thank you, Jan, for striking up that conversation and making that friendship, that relationship. And I know that Jan's actions are reflective of so many of yours, and I am so grateful for all that you do to reach out with hope and love to all that you encounter, but especially to those here in our little slice of heaven, this kingdom on earth. If you would like to connect with us in any of those ways and help with our mission and ministry here, I would invite you, those of you who are online, to give at our website, coascension.org, or text the word GIVE, 833-901-2138. All of our gifts work together to partner with one another and with God to do that work of kingdom building here on this earth. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust consumes and thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust consume and thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also.
Thank you.
The envelopes and cards in these offertory plates represent not only that which you have given us this day, but that which you have given us this past week as well. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given thee. Amen. The Great Thanksgiving Prayer A continues on page 361 in the Book of Common Prayer. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts.
We lift them to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is
right and a good and joyful thing always and everywhere to give thanks to you, Father Almighty, Creator of heaven and earth, through Jesus Christ our Lord, who on the first day of the week overcame death and the grave, and by his glorious resurrection opened to us the way of everlasting life. Therefore we praise you, joining our voices with angels and archangels and with all the company of heaven, who forever sing this hymn to proclaim the glory of your name. Holy and gracious Father, in your infinite love you made us for yourself. And when we had fallen into sin and become subject to evil and death, you in your mercy sent Jesus Christ, your only and eternal Son, to share our human nature, to live and die as one of us, to reconcile us to you, the God and Father of all. He stretched out his arms upon the cross and offered himself in obedience to your will, a perfect sacrifice for the whole world. On the night he was handed over to suffering and death, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks to you, he broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "Take, eat. This is my body which is given for you. Do this for the remembrance of me." After supper, he took the cup of wine. And when he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all of you. This is my blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith. We celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit, to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace. And at the last day, bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask through your Son, Jesus Christ. By him, and with him, and in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen. Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen.
Alleluia, Christ our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast. Alleluia.
These are the gifts of God for you, the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you, and feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Yeah.
post-communion prayer is found on page 365. Let us pray. Eternal God, Heavenly Father, you have graciously accepted us as living members of your Son, our Savior, Jesus Christ, and you have fed us with spiritual food in the sacrament of his body and blood. Send us now into the world in peace and grant us strength and courage to love and serve you with gladness and singleness of heart through Christ our Lord. Amen. May the peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be upon you this day and remain with you always. Amen. Please stand and join in singing hymn 494.
Let us go forth in the name of Christ. Alleluia, alleluia. Thanks be to God. Alleluia, alleluia.